Now that we know how crystalline silicon wafers are produced and doped, the next few videos will discuss design considerations to obtain high efficiency solar cells. In this video, we will look at the open circuit voltage and how we can influence this parameter by taking into account certain elements. A large open circuit voltage implies good utilization of the bandgap energy and is therefore a very important parameter in the design of a solar cell. We will discuss how certain processing techniques and design considerations can improve the crystalline silicon material purity and how the front surface of the solar cell is passivated. Before we discuss how to influence the open circuit voltage, we first need to have some understanding which physical processes determine the open circuit voltage. Therefore, we start by considering the band diagram of p-n junction in this slide. The left-hand diagram shows the band diagram of a p-n junction that is in thermal equilibrium. We can clearly recognize the quasi-neutral regions where the bands are horizontal and the depletion region where the bands curve. When excess charge carriers are generated in a semiconductor by illumination, it is not in thermal equilibrium anymore, and we have learned that we can define quasi-Fermi levels for electrons and holes, denoted as EFN and EFP respectively. When we look at the energy band diagram of a p-n junction under illumination and at open circuit voltage, the quasi-Fermi levels of the electrons and holes are separated by an energy difference equal to the electronic charge times the VOC. We have previously demonstrated that the minority carrier concentrations NP and PN are related to the quasi-Fermi levels. Taking into account the band diagram in the previous slide, we then can derive a relation between the minority carrier concentrations and the open circuit voltage, as shown here. Furthermore, in the PV energy conversion course, we have discussed the ambipolar transport equation that describes the concentration of electrons and holes in a semiconductor material as a function of time and space. Here, this equation is shown for electrons in p-type material. In static equilibrium, and assuming that the electric field strength in the quasi-neutral regions of the p and n-type parts is zero, we can reduce the equation to this form. When we look far away from the metallurgical junction and under uniform generation, the diffusion term can also be crossed out. This is a good first-order approximation. Under these conditions, the minority carrier concentrations approximate the generation rate times tau naught, representing the lifetime of the carriers. Please try to work this out yourself. Combining these two equations results in the following expression for the open circuit voltage of a solar cell. This expression states that the open circuit voltage is increasing with the generation rate GL, since higher generation rate will move the quasi-Fermi levels closer to the valence and conduction band edges. On the other hand, the intrinsic carrier density, which is a material property, will also contribute to the positions of the quasi-Fermi levels. But more importantly, we see that the minority carrier lifetime appears in this equation. This lifetime characterizes the recombination processes in the material. We've seen before that we can distinguish three recombination processes: radiative, Shockley Reed Hall or SRH, and Auger recombination. Radiative and Auger recombination depend on the carrier densities and are determined by the intrinsic material properties. These processes, therefore, cannot be influenced easily. SRA recombination, however, depends on the defect density in the material. As the carrier lifetime is inversely proportional to the trap density Nt, it is crucial to keep this value low. In this video, we will thus focus on lowering the SRH recombination rate. When we take a closer look at the p-type base of a crystalline silicon solar cell, we can identify this recombination mechanisms at three different locations. First, shock-to-read Hall recombination via defect states and impurities in the bulk of the material. The second mechanism is surface recombination by impurities or defects at the front surface of the cell. And the third is located at the interface between metal and semiconductor, where the recombination rate of charge carriers is very high. Now that we have identified these three sources that facilitate SRH recombination via defects and impurities resulting in traps for electrons and holes, we can think of approaches to reduce these recombination rates. We will start by looking at the material quality of a crystalline silicon wafer, or in other words, which type of defects are present. We will discuss methods to improve and optimize the surface quality, and we will show how contacts can be designed such that the area where metal and semiconductor are in direct contact is reduced. In another video, we discussed the production processes to obtain very high purity crystalline silicon wafers. In reality, a crystalline structure is not perfect. There are always defects in the material, which can be categorized in three types. First, we have point defects that can be further subdivided into vacancies, where atoms are missing, self-interstitial atoms, where atoms are misaligned in the lattice, substitution impurity atoms, where a large impurity replaces a silicon atom, or interstitial impurity atoms, which are similar atoms squeezed into space between the silicon atoms. The second type is a linear defect, where a line of atoms is missing, causing dangling and strained bonds within the lattice. The third type of defect are planar defects, where the atomic arrangement is suddenly changed from one part of the material to another. This type of defect is most observed in multicrystalline silicon. All three types of defects in the bulk of the material can serve as a trap for recombination of electrons and holes. These defect densities can be minimized to a manageable level by carefully controlling the ingot fabrication and by working in a clean environment. In order to reduce the recombination rate at the surface of the cell, it is very important to clean the wafer thoroughly and hereby remove organic and metallic contaminants and particles. One of the standard cleaning procedures of semiconductor materials is RCA cleaning. This figure shows a schematic of a crystalline silicon wafer surface with contaminants on it. The first step of this process is to create an oxide layer using ammonium hydroxide and hydrogen peroxide. The contaminants will then be partially embedded in the oxide layer, which is then removed by wet etching with hydrogen fluoride. In the final step, hydrochloric acid is used to remove any leftover contaminants. In between these cleaning steps, the wafers are rinsed in distilled water using an ultrasonic bath. This is a device that uses high-frequency sound wave to agitate a solvent and thereby kick loose the contaminants on the wafers. Secondly, the surface of the silicon wafer will feature many dangling bonds and asymmetric atomic structure. As an electron moves through the emitter layer towards a metal contact, these dangling bonds will act as trap and thereby facilitate recombination. This is again SRH recombination, as the trap states at the surface form available energy states within the band gap of silicon to facilitate this SRH. We have seen before that the total minority carrier lifetime can be expressed with this equation shown here. In this equation, S front and S back represent the surface recombination velocity that describes the recombination rate at the surface due to SRH recombination. From this equation, it is obvious that the minority carrier lifetime can be increased by reducing the surface recombination velocity. The density of dangling bonds on the surface should therefore be reduced. This is realized by depositing a passivation layer, most commonly a thin layer of silicon nitride with plasma-enhanced chemical vapor deposition. This production method is discussed in another video. The silicon nitride layer will passivate the dangling bonds and hereby reduce the trap density at the surface of the wafer. To summarize this video, we've shown that the open circuit voltage of a solar cell is directly affected by the material purity through Shotley-Reed Hall recombination in the bulk of the material. We've also discussed that the front surface of the wafer should be thoroughly cleaned to remove organic and metallic contaminants and particles, and that we can passivate the dangling bonds at the surface to reduce the surface recombination velocity. In the next video, we will continue with the recombination mechanism at the metal semiconductor interface, and we will introduce a design to have efficient charge carrier collection at the same time.